Have a look. Three things.
On TV.
Yes, I'm fine.
Yeah,
he's got to go on. Just walk past you. Okay. There's Rob on his side.
Step forward, guys.
Okay, we're about to go in, so if I can ask you to follow in behind the family.
It can be heavier than you think, okay? Just take Rich, when you do the foot, just rest it.
Just support,
shoulder,
just support in the middle as you come off.
Each other again. Okay.
So come off a little bit more. Okay, pause again for the next two. Now just come, lift up there. Come off and swing round this way.
The foot end.
So you turn round, face the head up. And then we'll lift up onto your shoulders when you're in the right position. Keep moving round a little bit more. That's it. Okay, up onto your shoulders. And when I say thank you, gentlemen, just start on your left foot nice and steady. And then small steps so you don't bump into each other, but take it easy. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
to the Angel Hotel in Leamington Spa for refreshments and an opportunity to reminisce with them about their mum. And finally, should anyone wish to do so, donations may be made in Yvette's memory to the always excellent Myton Hospice. Now, this service today has been especially created by Nikki, Rich and Bria in love and affection for their mum. And we will hear a story of her life, reflections from Yvette's close friend Elena, very personal tributes from each of her children and from family in New Zealand, and pieces of music that meant so much to Yvette. And we've just been listening to the Spice Girls. I can't remember the title. Mama, I Love You. And a little bit later on in the service, I will be offering anyone in the chapel the opportunity to stand up, put the hand up, just to share a memory, totally informal, nothing stuffy whatsoever. If you just have a memory or a little story that you'd like to share with everybody, if you put your hand up, you can either talk where you are or come up to the lectern. But a little bit later on, we'll do that. At the end of the ceremony, there's going to be a release of three doves. So we will invite you all, on behalf of Nikki, Rich and Bria and the family, to follow us round onto the lawn area, just over there, where the release of the doves will take place. Now, to lose a loved one at any time is devastating enough. But for the family to lose Yvette, and at such a young age, must be almost too much to bear. So it's absolutely pointless me standing here at this lectern this afternoon and offering you any glib words or well-worn platitudes to soften the blow of losing you there. Because the truth is, the pain and the sense of loss that you're feeling today is far too great for that. So perhaps, just for today, we shouldn't even try, but instead, focus on and remember all of the happy times and the memories that you have all shared with Yvette. Yvette was a one-off. She was a maverick, and she was a lady who had a style all of her own, as you will notice by the zebra print coffin and the horse-drawn carriage. Now, when I met with Nikki, Rich and Ria the other day, I casually mentioned that because Yvette loved zebras, how great would it have been if we could have harnessed them for the carriage today? At which point, Rich told me that he used to work on a safari car. And it just crossed my mind for a nanosecond, is he thinking of zebra wrestling? But luckily he didn't. But in all honesty, I'm genuinely indebted to the family for all of the information that they have given me for the story of their mum's life. Yvette was born on the 6th of May 1962 in Shipston-on-Stour. But due to circumstances and the era of Yvette's birth, her mother was unable to support her, and so she was put up for adoption. So Yvette, as an infant, was adopted by George Henry Hubert Tant and his wife Maud. And as she would tell people in later years, some of the happiest times of her life were between the age of 6 weeks and 10 years. Sadly, when George and Maud separated, this was when Yvette found out she had been adopted. And we have no idea has to the effect this time on a 10-year-old girl. After her parents had split up, Yvette was living with her dad in Landor Road, Whitmash, and she was a pupil at Whitmash Junior School, and from there on to Moyton Senior. After leaving full-time education, Yvette had many and varied jobs, including working in a butcher's shop, a jeweller's, a fish and chip shop, a shell garage, and a hairdresser's. And she also joined the Territorial Army. And it was while she was in the TA that she would meet another fellow soldier, Richard Brown. Now they were clearly attracted to each other, and they began dating. And it didn't take long for the feelings of love that they had for each other to become so strong that they became husband and wife together. Both Yvette and Richard were to celebrate a truly joyous event in their married lives with the arrival of their daughter Nikki. In the late 80s, the family decided to visit New Zealand and to check out for themselves whether this most beautiful country might become their permanent home. On their return to Britain, Yvette and Richard became parents for the second time with the birth of their son Rich. And quite obviously, New Zealand had captivated the family. And so they all moved over there to live and settled in the new Plymouth area. Unfortunately, Richard and Yvette were to split up, and Richard returned to Britain with Nikki and Rich, leaving Yvette behind in New Zealand. Some 2 years later, she returned back to the UK, and very briefly was reunited with Richard. But it wasn't destined to last, and so they divorced. So Yvette went to live in a property of her own in Cowdray Close. In her working life, Yvette worked in a factory for a time, and also as a door lady in the nightclubs of Leamington Spa. And it was during this time that she would meet Steve. They moved in together in a house in Cobden Avenue, and as a married couple, became proud parents to their beautiful daughter, Rhea. Now, when Nikki and Rich were small, they remembered the wonderful and happy memories of their childhood. Their mum was bringing show dogs and showing them at various dog shows. And I've seen the photographs myself of Yvette running alongside the border collie as he ran over a series of obstacles. Yvette, as you all know, was a very attractive lady, and she was heavily involved with marketing and promotional work for motorcycle firms such as Harley Davidson. And again, the photographs, they speak for themselves. Yvette, with the ubiquitous big hair of the 80s and the 90s, promoting various products to do with motorbikes. She even had her own CBR Honda, which made me jealous, and with all the leather safety gear on it. And she's done something else which I wish I could have done. She'd even ridden round the world famous TT course on the Isle of Man. You see, Yvette was a vivacious lady who embraced life and lived it to the full. She had told her own children of the excitement that she used to get organising all-night rave parties in the area when they were distinctly unpopular with the authorities. And apparently she had a BMW convertible, which he used to drive around town with the top down, blasting out this rave music on these large speakers that she'd go. Clearly enriching the lives of all in the Warwick area. Nicky and Rich also remember their mum being an excellent cook. And apparently there was no greater supporter of Aubrey Allen's the Butcher's than Yvette. She would not buy meat from anywhere else at all. And apparently her spaghetti bolognese and the legendary beef skirt stew would, I am reliably informed, win prizes. Yvette herself was very partial to scampi. And she's also been known to have the odd glass of Pinot Blush, Prosecco, or pink champagne, just purely to aid digestion. And unwinding at home, in front of the TV, she loved to watch CSI, Jeremy Kyle, The Chase, Anton Deck, and something called The Tipping Point, which I have no idea what that is. Becoming a nan to Summer and Brandon meant so very much to Yvette. And she was known by the children as Nan Ma. In 2006, Yvette was diagnosed with breast cancer. And she had to undergo the very invasive chemo and radiotherapy treatments. But this most courageous of ladies fought it with every ounce of will in her body. And she beat it. So it is so incredibly cruel that this most appalling of diseases would return in 2011. And this time, not even someone with the indomitable character of Yvette could win. What made this situation even more unbearable was that the cancer would prevent Yvette from being a fully hands-on nanma to Summer and Brandon. I've talked about the character of Yvette, and I'm going to highlight exactly what strength Yvette actually possessed. 4 weeks before the end, Yvette was on a hen party on Ladies' Day at Antrim. After that, she went to see Gary Barlow in concert. And the final one, and not even I can believe this, on Wednesday the 23rd of April, Yvette went on a makeup course and passed it with flying colours, receiving a certificate. 3 days later, this most unique, wonderful, and greatly loved lady passed peacefully away at home. Yvette's suffering is now at an end, and she's finally at peace. But her passing has left a huge void in the lives of all who knew and loved her. And it is on this day of all days that all of our thoughts and prayers go out to Nicky, Rich, Rhea, and to all of the family, all of us here in this chapel today, share in your loss. Could I invite Nicky, Richard, Rhea to come forward, please, with their tributes?
Between us, and distance keeps us apart. never change. The love inside our heart will not always be there with you. Every minute of the day, but always here with us. In at least 1,000 ways, whether it be a thought or a moment that we've shared, it only takes a second to remember your being here. From a million miles by air, really this on our behalf does not seem fair. We may not be able to be there today, but we will be there with you again someday.
God only takes the best. God saw the ships getting tired and her keel was meant to be. So he put his arms around her and whispered, "Come with me." With tearful eyes we watched her suffer and watched her fade away. Although we loved her dearly, he could not make her stay. The golden heart stopped beating, the warm blue heart to rest. God broke her heart to breathe with. He only takes the best.
The love is only with me. I know it was so with me. Especially today, because we share a place and see what death can take away. And sometimes, when I'm wishing that means to say that it's time, a butterfly or a rainbow, let me know you're doing fine. I will kill my brother to just down softly from the sky. I know you're trying to stay with it, but it seems forever.
To the dead of night with our husbands and our babies fast asleep in their beds after getting a was extremely organised all of the time, and she was like Mary Poppins with this big bag of stuff that she carried around with her. Nail kits, sewing kits, makeup, tissue, you name it. She always seemed to have something in her bag to deal with the moment in hand. There was a time when we were in a restaurant with our girls, Jessica and Rhea, and they were about 5 years old. As usual, kids get bored waiting for their food, but as ever, Yvette came prepared, delved into her bag, only to come out with 2 whoopee cushions. Much to the annoyance of other diners, the girls had loads of fun while all 4 of us had tears rolling down our cheeks. She was a fun mum as well as a fun friend. She always tried to make moments with her children times to remember. She always used to take time to think about what gifts they would like, how to make their birthday special, and was always so proud of their achievements, however big or small. She was the proudest nan mum when Summer and Brandon came into this world, and she talked endlessly of how proud she was of Nikki and what a great mum she is. She was proud of Rich too, and all that he achieved in the horse racing world. Towards the end of her life, she told me how happy she was that both Nikki and Rich had found their dames to look after them. Rhea was her baby, and she loved her so very much, and was the proudest mum of her new baby I think I've ever seen. Rhea was always immaculately dressed, and Yvette would spend hours playing with her and organising little tea parties so that other children could come and play. As Rhea got older, she adored spending time with her, doing mum and daughter things like shopping and doing her hair. Yvette told me that she especially, when they were doing arty things together, like colouring in or making things, she told me that they were the special mother and daughter times. She wanted more than anything for Rhea to remember her when she was well. Rhea, all of your mum's friends and your family will help you remember her. That's a promise. One of her greatest gifts is that she was so accepting of other people. She had friends from all walks of life. Yvette didn't care what colour, race or sexual orientation you were, so long as you knew to have fun and never wear your label sticking out of your clothes. It was a personal annoyance of hers, and I'm sure I'm not the only one here today to remember Yvette getting a pair of scissors out of that bag of hers to cut off any offending label that was in her pack. She was generous-spirited. I was trying to think when I'd ever heard her be jealous of her friend's successes, but I could not think of any one time. She was always so proud of what those close to her had achieved. That is a remarkable trait in any person, and a gift that she shared with us. Yvette was the best party organiser ever. Her Halloween parties became legendary when we would all dress up with Yvette in the centre of making it all happen and ensuring that everyone had a good time. Sometimes she was a little crazy, but in the nicest way. I remember somebody bought her a foot square piece of land which had a title with it. I think it was actually Michelle who bought it for her. She was really excited until I pointed out that you can't actually use the title unless you're standing on the land. Undeterred, I went to meet up with her at the gym for a coffee a few days later. As usual, she was late, so I checked to see if she was still a member. "Can I check to see if you've got Mrs. Dorgan on your system?" I asked. The reply came back, "No, we don't have Mrs. Dorgan, but we do have Lady Dorgan." Yvette was feisty and an amazingly strong woman. In the face of cancer, she wasn't going to be beaten. She fought the disease the first time with such gusto. I remember she came to my house one morning after having chemo, with her head in a headscarf after losing her hair. I asked her, did she want to sit down and have a rest? And she said, no, plenty of time for pushing up daisies. I'm off to wear robes in a minute. Crazy, but that is actually true. Obviously, the cancer came back harder the second time, but during the whole of the 3 years and 2 months that she chose to fight it, you never heard her complain about the pain. 2 days before she passed away, I was sat on the sofa with my arm around her, and she looked so tired, and I asked her, are you sure you want to keep fighting this, honey? Her response was, I want to be here for as long as possible so that my children and my grandchildren remember me. What else can I do? Her spirit to fight in adversity was breathtaking. I asked her also recently what had been the hardest thing of all. She said that it was the first time when she lost her hair. She'd got used to wearing a wig or headscarf, but one day she wanted to go swimming. She said she got undressed, put on her swimsuit, and thought, I can do this, I can do this, but couldn't face taking off the scarf to show her bald head. Then she had an idea. She opened her locker lip gloss and thought, yep, I can do this now. Took off a scarf and went for a swim. Like she said to me, I might have been bald, but my lips looked fabulous. She was beyond glamorous. She was perfectionist in the way she looked, and always was the one who turned heads when she walked into a room. She loved to help others look glamorous too, and there have been many times she has fiddled with her children and friends' hair, clothes and makeup to make us more presentable. She would be very proud of us all today. Someone saw her photo at my house the other day and said, isn't she a stunning and striking woman? I think that describes Yvette perfectly. Being the organiser that she was, many people know that she has had a hand in the organisation of today. So it's no surprise then that a woman who always makes an amazing entrance would make such a spectacular departure. Yvette, my friend, I hope I've done you proud. But before I go, I wanted to say that the words that I think best describe you. There are so many, but I think unique and irreplaceable says it all. Goodbye, Vesta, and remember you are loved.
If anybody has a story that they'd like to share with us, it can be as short as you like. Please just raise your hand. It's totally informal, honestly. If anybody just wants to share a memory.
I'll say it. I've only been in vet for a few years. With my wife, Rosina. She did a beauty course, and the vet actually came and worked for my company, my simulators at the Coventry Airport. She was obviously in a lot of discomfort, but her whole manner where she greeted customers and looked after them despite her discomfort was just extraordinary, and I have to say she's probably the bravest person I've ever met in my life.
Thank you very much indeed. Yes, please,
sir. Bet's very friendly. We spent a night while together, all big soup points, and one day Steve said to us, why is it we've all got 1,000 seats and Yvette's got 600 CC. Why are you guys always going up? Well, in a vet, a pair of letters.
Jealous of the Angels by Jen.
There has taken back you. Family, it really is one day at a time,
as they tried to come to terms with life without Yvette. But their memories, they're like yours, the here and the heart. And nothing will ever diminish or take those memories away. They're there for good. So please, when you leave here today, to return with the family to the Angel Hotel, please tell your own stories and anecdotes about Yvette, and I'll bet you've got plenty. And share these with the family, please. Because the most important thing of all is to keep the memory of this exceptional lady alive. Yvette Carrington will be greatly missed by all who knew and loved her. But she will never, ever be forgotten. And her memory will live on in your hearts forever. Now, as we conclude our service today by playing another of Yvette's favourite songs, the family will come forward and place their floral tributes to the catalogue. So, could only be this one. Let's get this party started by then.
Family have asked for the release of three beautiful white doves. The releasing of the doves is the symbol of the carrying away of the spirit. But before the release, I will read an appropriate verse that the family have chosen. If you could just bear with me while I hand over the doves.
Oh, you pet.
Don't let it go.
Until you get that one. There you go, let it. What are you looking for in there?
Don't leave it in
that one.
Yeah. When you let them go, like, you just throw them away from it.
Yeah, throw them away and open your hands.
Oh God. To be read in memory of Yvette is called The Final Flight. Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard his call. I turned my back and I left it all. I could not stay another day, to laugh, to love, to work, to play. Task left undone, must stay that way. I found peace at the close of the day. If my parting has left a void, then fill it now with a remembered joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss, are these things I too will miss. Be not burdened with times of sorrow. I wish you all the sunshine of tomorrow. My life's been full, I've savoured much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Perhaps my time seems all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with undue grief. Lift up your heart and share with me. God wanted me now, he set me free.
Last time I saw you, you were blonde.
Weren't you?
Yeah. I'm around the corner now, all right. See
you soon.
No. Yeah.
Well done, thank you for coming. So I'm trying to give you the updates when we were getting here.
Did your mum cry, darling? Are you all right?
Yeah.
Right, listen, I need to just give you this card because we did have a collection on the grave, which we've donated.
Actually, just sod the Red Bull, aren't you?
Yeah. Oh, gosh.
I lose about 5 hours every day, but it's more fun. Yeah. And Jennifer.
There might have been four, but there's a queue up there.
She's enjoying last night. It's going to be... Yeah. So, yeah. Got my best D.
I'm going to get a party start waving out the windows.
Is it like the limos you get, you know?
Yeah.
Have you got the champagne in there?
See
more about that.
What are you doing?
Yeah, put them in there, bud.
Yeah,
we'll take a bottle, though.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.